November 11th, Daily Video Bible Reading from the Net Bible, Ezekiel chapters 37 and 38 from the Old Testament. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord, and placed me in the midst of the valley, and it was full of bones. He made me walk all around among them. I realized there were a great many bones in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said to him, "Sovereign Lord, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy over these bones and tell them, 'Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord.' This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones. Look, I'm about to infuse breath into you, and you will live. I will put tendons on you and muscles over you, and will cover you with skin. I will put breath in you, and you will live. Then you will know that I am the Lord." So I prophesied as I was commanded. There was a sound when I prophesied. I heard a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to bone. As I watched, I saw tendons on them. Then muscles appeared, and skin covered over them from above. But there was no breath in them. He said to me, "Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, 'This is what the Sovereign Lord says. Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these corpses so that they may live.' So I prophesied as I was commanded, and the breath came into them. They lived and stood on their feet in an extremely great army. Then he said to me, "Son of man, these bones are all the house of Israel. Look, they are saying, 'Our bones are dry. Our hope has perished. We are cut off.' Therefore, prophesy and tell them, 'This is what the Sovereign Lord says. Look, I'm about to open your graves and will raise you from your graves, my people. I will bring you to the land of Israel. Then you will know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and raise you from your graves, my people. I will place my breath in you and you will live. I will give you rest in your own land. Then you will know that I am the Lord. I have spoken and I will act, declares the Lord." The word of the Lord came to me. "As for you, son of man, take one branch and write on it, 'For Judah and for the Israelites associated with him.' Then take another branch and write on it, 'For Joseph, the branch of Ephraim, and all the house of Israel associated with him.' Join them as one stick. They will be as one in your hand. When your people say to you, 'Will you not tell us what these things mean?' Tell them, 'This is what the Sovereign Lord says. Look, I'm about to take the branch of Joseph, which is in the hand of Ephraim, and the tribes of Israel associated with him, and I will place them on the stick of Judah and make them into one stick. They will be one in my hand. The sticks you write on will be in your hand in front of them. Then tell them, 'This is what the Sovereign Lord says. Look, I'm about to take the Israelites from among the nations where they have gone. I will gather them from round about and bring them to their land. I will make them one nation in the land, on the mountains of Israel, and one king will rule over them all. They will never again be two nations and never again be divided into two kingdoms. They will not defile themselves with their idols, their detestable things, and all their rebellious deeds. I will save them from all their unfaithfulness by which they sinned. I will purify them. They will become my people, and I will become their God. My servant David will be king over them. There will be one shepherd for all of them. They will follow my regulations and carefully observe my statutes. They will live in the land I gave to my servant Jacob, in which your fathers lived. They will live in it, they and their children and their grandchildren forever. David, my servant, will be prince over them forever. I will make a covenant of peace with them. It will be a perpetual covenant with them. I will establish them, increase their numbers, and place my sanctuary among them forever. My dwelling place will be with them. I will be their God, and they will be my people. Then when my sanctuary is among them forever, the nations will know that I, the Lord, sanctify Israel. The word of the Lord came to me. Son of man, turn toward Gog of the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal. Prophesy against him and say, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Look, I am against you, Gog, chief prince of Meshech and Tubal. I will turn you around, put hooks into your jaws, and bring you out with all your army, horses and horsemen, all of them fully armed, a great company with shields of different types, all of them armed with swords. Persia, Ethiopia, and Put are with them, all of them with shields and helmets. They are joined by Gomer with all its troops, and by Beth Togarma from the remote parts of the north with all its troops. Many peoples are with you. Be ready and stay ready, you and all your companies assembled around you, and be a guard for them. After many days you will be summoned. In the latter years you will come to a land restored from the ravages of war, with many people gathered on the mountains of Israel that had long been in ruins. Its people were brought out from the peoples, and all of them will be living securely. You will advance. You will come like a storm. You will be like a cloud covering the earth, you, all your troops, and the many other peoples with you. This is what the sovereign Lord says. On that day, thoughts will come into your mind, and you will devise an evil plan. You will say, I will invade a land of unwalled towns. I will advance against those living quietly in security, all of them living without walls and barred gates, to loot and plunder, to attack the inhabited ruins and the people gathered from the nations who are acquiring cattle and goods, who live at the center of the earth. Sheba and Dedan and the traders of Tarshish, with all its young warriors, will say to you, have you come to loot? Have you assembled your armies to plunder, to carry away silver and gold, to take away cattle and goods, to haul away a great amount of spoils? Therefore, prophesy, son of man, and say to Gog, this is what the sovereign Lord says. On that day when my people Israel are living securely, you will take notice and come from your place, from the remote parts of the north, you and many peoples with you, all of them riding on horses, a great company and a vast army. You will advance against my people Israel like a cloud covering the earth. In the latter days, I will bring you against my land so that the nations may acknowledge me, when before their eyes I magnify myself through you, O Gog. This is what the sovereign Lord says. Are you the one of whom I spoke in former days, by my servants the prophets of Israel, who prophesied in those days that I would bring you against them? On that day when Gog invades the land of Israel, declares the sovereign Lord, my rage will mount up in my anger, in my zeal, in the fire of my fury. I declare that on that day there will be a great earthquake in the land of Israel. The fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, the wild beast, all the things that creep on the ground, and all people who live on the face of the earth will shake at my presence. The mountains will topple, the cliffs will fall, and every wall will fall to the ground. I will call for a sword to attack Gog on all my mountains, declares the sovereign Lord. Every man's sword will be against his brother. I will judge him with plague and bloodshed. I will rain down on him, his troops, and the many peoples who are with him, a torrential downpour, hailstones, fire, and brimstones. I will exalt and magnify myself. I will reveal myself before many nations. Then they will know that I am the Lord. God, we know that the vision that you gave Ezekiel about the bones, probably one of the most familiar chapters by Christians and non-Christians. We know that that has a couple different meanings for what it means in Ezekiel, referring to the exiles' despair and what you can do for them. And it also points toward, like so many things in the Old Testament, it points towards your son's resurrection in the New Testament as well. I always get so excited at those parts of the Old Testament. It's almost like secret clues that point to what's coming, and the amazing power of the resurrection of your son is shown clearly for the second part of this piece about the dry bones. But I also think about, as I was reading, and I think about a couple applications to our own lives as well. Probably not just two either, but a couple that came to me is I have many people in my world, known and unknown, that have broken my heart. And I don't mean from a worldly standpoint. I mean from a point that they aren't walking with you, God. They are not saved. Some of them are adamant about it. Some of them are starting to ask questions, and every gambit in between. But I get really excited when I read chapters like this, because even though I should always know it, how big you are, how powerful you are, I guess sometimes I either just take it for granted or kind of gloss over it. But I know that you can come into each and every single one of those situations, each and every single one of those lives, and breathe that life into them, that life that is you, that eternal life that is you. You can breathe that into them. You gave them life originally here on earth. You chose for them to be born here on earth. You created them. You developed them. You gave them what they have inside of them, how they think, how they process things, how they feel, how they see things. And I also know that you can come in your timing, and make them truly live, to truly live with a new heart, following you and being in a relationship with you. So God, that passage does give me reassurance that I know in even what looks like to me the most hopeless of situations, that you, like always, bring hope into those situations. You breathe life into so many things. And the other thing I was thinking about when I was reading this about Ezekiel's vision was the dry times in my life. I can probably make you a list of all the times where my life felt like a desert, dried up bleached bones on it, probably a few tumbleweeds tumbling. I was just dry. I went to church, but only because I had to show up at church. Didn't read my Bible, talked to you once in a while, but that was about, like, my heart just wasn't in it. And in those situations, God, I know that you come in and breathe life into us, and you breathe this freshness into us that reminds us that we are yours. Today I posted on Facebook a quote I found someplace that said, "Sometimes I become suddenly afraid that my life is a huge, disorganized blob. I am not perfect. I make wrong decisions. I am inconsistent. However, when I look at Jesus, I see order, beauty, goodness, and love. I see perfection. Then Jesus looks at me, smiles, and says, 'You like what you see? The reason why I died on the cross is for you to have what I have. Open your eyes, child. You are loved, righteous, rich, gorgeous, favored, blessed, good, and skilled. You have value in my heart. I am the one keeping you alive because you are mine. I have plans for you.'" And I think that reflects very much what Ezekiel's talking about in this vision he has, this prophecy that he is talking about, that you gave him. This hopelessness that we have here in this world, whether we're Christians or not Christians, I know only with you and having been saved by you, is there any part of me that has hope. That even though every single day I'm baffled why we still exist here on earth, because we have just destroyed things after destroyed things after destroyed things. And yet I get to wake up every morning and thank a God who I get to spend eternity with. I get to go through my day talking to my God who personally made me and wrote my name in a book before the worlds were even created. How crazy awesome is that? And I get to go to bed praying and thanking a God who is bigger than anything else in this world. Any problems, any troubles, any gossip, any drama, my God is bigger than all of those. And somehow, God, you want me included in part of that. And you want everyone listening to this video, you want them to be part of that too. God, that's a love that we can't comprehend. I know we try, but we can't comprehend. But I do thank you for the breath you breathe into me when I am dry, when I have allowed myself to become dry. I've slacked off on my reading of the Bible, of talking to you, of communicating with other Christians, of doing what I'm supposed to, and my life is just dried out. And you come in and you breathe life back into me. You breathe freshness back into me. God, I know I didn't do anything to deserve any of this. In fact, I did quite the opposite. And I know there's no way I can earn any of this either. That somehow you have a love for us that allows us to have what we don't deserve. God, I thank you for taking something that is despair and dry and hopeless and bleached out and without life, and you give us life. You give us reasons to live and to glorify you every single day by the life you've given us. And that life that we received through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.